Hello, my name's George Neofitu, and I'm from the Magpie House Holistic Centre in Upway, on the outskirts of Melbourne. And we have another interview with Solihin today, and the topics might include fate versus free will. All right, that's one of the ideas we've got for today. Other stuff that we do here, look us up on magpiehouse.com.au, and you'll see a range of activities and events on body, mind, spirit, and of course yoga, the yoga school. So what would you like to say about yourself, Solihin?
Well, hi George, thanks very much for this opportunity. Just introducing myself, my name's Solihin Millen. I've got a very interesting background in that I'm an academic and also set my sights on finding out who I am in a spiritual sense. So I've got both this sort of academic side and the psychic side. I was trained in physics and applied maths and worked with computers all my life, and yet I have had the most incredible spiritual journey, which, you know, I'd love to share with you all.
Yeah, I regard what I've been doing as a spiritual journey as well, and I actually come from a telecommunications engineering background, and I knew I had to make the shift, and that was back in 2002, and so we set up this centre in response to that. Yeah, so with the suggested topic, fate versus free will, one thing we can say about fate is it's for all things expected, in a way. And so do we have a fixed fate, or do we have some leeway as we go along our journey? What's your view on that?
Well, it's a very intricate and subtle and deep subject, right? Mm-hmm. And you'll find out in the end that everything exists. And it really depends on your point of view. So where you're coming from, what is your level of consciousness? Now, you know, I can only speak from my experience, and forgive me if it sounds strange, but this is all an illusion, what we're going through. Mm-hmm. And it's an illusion for a reason. It's an illusion for a purpose. And it seems to have three components of it is motion, time, and space. Yeah. And that's part of it because it's all vibrational. And if you think of a DVD, and nowadays particularly a game, how you can actually create this game and then go to any part of the game and play any part of the game on a computer, or change the game. So if you're the programmer, you can go and change it. So time and space to me has this flexibility, that it's totally flexible. Even we, as human beings, have the ability to change time and space, and I've seen it in my experiences. Now, the model I choose for, you know, analyzing, talking, and discussing these issues is the Vedic model. You know, there are many models, and you can choose the one that suits you, right? But I find that the Vedic model suits me, the model of yoga, which includes the ideas of chakras, and I'm sure you've all heard of chakras. Do you think there's any need to go into that at all?
If it comes from a from a yoga perspective, we've explored that.
And but for our viewers, those. Do you think there's any need to go into chakras?
We can just mention that there is a...
The obvious thing is that we're all conscious, right? Mm-hmm. The Vedas really describe this God who does or doesn't exist depending on who you are as Satchit Ananda. They're Sanskrit words, and Sat means I am. And I think we can agree that we are. It also says, I am aware, and I think we can agree that we're aware. And the final one is, I am bliss, joy, love. Mm-hmm. And I think to a great degree, we can agree on that as well. So that is actually the definition of this great oneness of this universe, right? Mm. Now, some people say that it is, and this is very childlike. I mean, you can help me out, but the childlike view is that this is all just a great experiment. It's still a great, pleasant experience, and this great consciousness enjoys all of this experience, right? So all of this multitude of diversity exists, and all these things happen, right? Particularly for us in time and space. And then we have to decide, well, you know, is everything fixed and cannot be changed, or is it malleable? Is it, you know, is there free will? And it really depends from which level you're looking, right, in your consciousness. Because if we take the chakra model, and, you know, interrupt me anytime you like.
Well, I was going to throw in, there's a tantric saying, there's nothing to do in this world of bamboo, right? That implies that it's not real, right, from what you were saying before. But everybody needs a hobby, right? In other words, we are here by choice from a higher level. And you could call it an experiment. It's just the most exciting adventure for the soul to actually experience who and what it is.
Well, the word they use, sorry, is creator.
Yes, that's
it's
right.
A lovely word, isn't it?
Yeah, yeah.
The creator, like the artist, like the one who makes it all happen.
Yeah, we have the opportunity to demonstrate that we are creators. And once we evolve to a certain level, we may not choose to continue coming back to this realm of duality, because it's a tough place to be.
It's interesting, I've wrote a little story for children called a little Story.
Yeah.
And it's for kids 3 to 103. And it's sort of succinctly puts us all together. But the vision that I see, and this is from experience, right? It's not just sort of mindy stuff, is that we're all angels. All of us are angels. And we as angels, you know, you're in a very fine position and you can understand a great deal about the Creator. And we want to merge or become part of that Creator. We want to reach that exalted state. And so, speaking as a child, we can't just do that, because this great Creator creates what one might regard as reality. And so it's created this illusion for us to play in. And so we're playing in an illusion. And we have these three aspects of our existence, which is really very much related to vibration, which is creation, and we are all angels, and so we wanted to progress and merge with the great Creator, which we were told was not a good idea, because the Creator creates reality, and we as angels don't know about that.
So what about the angels that transgress on us?
Yeah, we'll get to that.
Let me carry
this thought. So anyway, the Creator said, yeah, okay, I'll give you this opportunity, and created an illusion, right? Then placed all these angels in the illusion, so gave us this second degree, which is pretty tough, as we all know, and that's what we're doing here. Now, the whole thing's made of vibration. So it's got creation, music, and destruction. That's the three processes. And so in terms of our lives, we go through all these processes through many lives, and everything is being created and destroyed, and it's all music of the spheres. Now, as far as how much control we have over that, personally, my understanding is that the whole thing's done. It's already done because it's all an illusion. It's like whoever wrote the game has written the game. You know, it's finished. Everything is known, everything's going to happen and whatever. However, if you only know that if you're at this very, very highest level, like you created the game. Okay, it's the highest level of... So that suggests that there is no free will, right?
Well, when I get a chance, I'll throw
Let me finish the thought, right? Yep. So if we go down to the lowest level of consciousness, and we've got seven chakras, and let's just say that each chakra in our bodies has a different degree of consciousness, and if we go to the lowest one, which is the Muladhara chakra, which is the material level of energy, the intelligence at that level is pretty low, right? It thinks that it can do anything it likes. There is absolute free will. You do whatever you like, nothing matters, right? Now, I don't know if you want to talk about the law of karma.
It's obviously related, but what I was going to say about what you mentioned, that it's all been set in concrete, well, my understanding is all the possibilities are set in concrete. It doesn't mean you follow any one of those timelines. You're only going to follow one. And that's where the free will comes in. You've got a limited number of choices you can make throughout a lifetime, and you can make those choices as you go along. And they have consequences, obviously. But the choices that you don't make still exist. They also exist. It's a little bit like a, there is the analogy that your life is like a book. And it can be picked up and you can look at any page. Right? That's a linear progression, right, from start to finish. But the information I work with tells us that all the possibilities are already planned out. It's like a video game. You've got plenty of different directions you can go, and you choose just one, and it might be a bit of a maze. If you get too far off the track, then your guides will start pushing you back onto your track. And if you go beyond recovery of that track, then your life may not be worth progressing from that point. And at a higher level, you might decide to leave this realm.
Cool.
So all the possibilities are there. Yeah. You choose it. You choose just one, and that's your free will.
Well, going further into that, there's the law of karma, which I'm sure many of us are familiar with, but it means that if you make an action, there's a result of your action. And so we actually create our futures by the actual actions and thoughts, feelings that we have. And there, as you said, there's flexibility of what you wish to do. So if we've got, let's simplify, if we've got these seven major chakras, each one of them has got a different degree of consciousness. And so the different degrees of perceived fate or perceived free will. And it's a very flexible situation, as you rightly say, and I'm sure my understanding is totally incomplete, but it's an example, trying to show an example of what will or free will is, or fate. And I just don't know how much freedom we have, really.
Yeah, my understanding is you do have a life plan. We do plan our life from the beginning, but then it's like we do it in pencil lines. Like it's like a contract, but man-made contracts are different to divine contracts. You can change them at any time.
Right.
It's like you've got a. It's in pencil and you can erase the lines and you can change direction. But each one of those directions is already planned out. And so if you take the line of transgressing on others, then the downside of that is you'll feel the transgression back on yourself, and that's the karma situation.
Yes.
If you've got an absolute faith in fate and it's all fixed, that's what fate will do. It'll give you a timeline where you don't have any choice, because you think, I don't have any choices, and so that's what happens.
Yes. Right?
That's how powerful we
are.
Well,
in my model, saying I don't have any choice would be a consciousness of a lower chakra.
So well, perhaps a young soul would be working with that situation.
Yeah. Another very nice area of this is the travelling in time and space. And in this model of fate and free will, it actually turns out that we can travel in time forward or backwards, and we can travel in space forwards or backwards. And we can actually modify time and space. Now, this is part of this free will. And I say it as an example, if we look at miracles, such as the miracles that Jesus did or have been reported, he was able to, I believe, move in time and space and change things, so that, and there was a great gifted Russian, I hope he's still alive, called Grigory Grabovoy. Have you heard of him?
Not sure.
Who can do these great miracles. And I personally have seen many miracles, particularly in India, and strangely enough in Melbourne. And I know that this is possible, to change time and space. In fact, myself, I have travelled into the future, and this is a very good experience of knowing the future, because there's a very good test. Because if you think you've travelled into the future, and then it actually happens, then you've got a pretty good test of.
Well, we've got the concept of déjà vu, where you kind of remember what's happening in the future.
Yes.
That is a, from what I know, it's tapping into future energy, because you've got all these choices from this present moment, all spanning out in different directions. Well, each one of those futures exists, right? But you
and
still
so
have to choose.
And so when it arrives, it. Yeah.
Yeah, you can actually. Through meditation or whatever, you can see where that timeline goes. And if you don't like it, don't go that way. Don't make that choice which takes you that direction.
Right.
So it's better to choose something which is a bit more friendly. Yeah.
Now, great religions have, it's all a wonderful subject, this. Great religions, and particularly Islam, I've dabbled in various religions in my journey. And, I believe that the word Muslim means someone who surrenders to God, right? So this is the meaning of this, being a Muslim. And surrender to God is a very interesting concept, because it means that you are always focusing on God, or focusing on the highest, or hoping for the best, or wanting to do your best, right? And you can, in essence, let go of that feeling that you're doing anything, and then allow the creator of the whole show to be the doer.
Mm-hmm. That's the concept of Vishvara Pranidhana in yoga.
Yeah. So that. Sorry.
Yeah. Okay, what was the point? Because there was a valid point.
Yeah, what I'm getting at is that there's this. It's a wonderful discussion, this fate or free will, because many of the greatest thinkers, the spiritual people in our experience, end up saying that we do nothing. that all of this is done. This is the doer, while our lower consciousness believes that we are doing. It's not the case, because the whole thing is being run by the Creator. The Creator is doing, right? So that's a nice one to throw into this
mix. Just a point on that. When we're working from the ego, let's call it the lesser self, then the will that we apply may not be in alignment with God's will, if you want to put it that way, right? However, as you evolve and you start aligning the personal will with the will of the divine, then your will becomes God's will.
Exactly.
And that's what it means. Yeah, it doesn't mean you just let things happen. Let's say from the shaman world, they say we become a conduit for the spirit.
Yes. Well, you know, yoga is precisely the same thing, and the lovely model that they have in yoga is of the chariot and the four horses. I don't know if you've seen it. Red, yellow, white, and black horses. It's typically associated with Krishna. So Krishna is the driver of the chariot. We're standing on the chariot as the charioteer, and the horses are the lower chakras, you know, the passions that put us into this world. And they all have different consciousnesses, and they need to be controlled. So there's these two levels of ego. You know, there's in the 70s, there was ego is not a dirty word. Remember that song? It depends, because you've got different types of ego, right? You've got the lower ego from the lower chakras, and the Atma, which is the center, the spirit of God that's within us, has a very strong ego, right? Mm-hmm. And that's the perfect ego. And so you've said just the same thing, that we can align these lower egos, and in the Vedas they say control the horses. So when you've got your chariot, you're controlling the different horses, and then you align all your actions to the higher experience, and then it all starts to work beautifully. So it's just a fascinating idea of free will and
faith. One of the descriptions relating to the chakras is, if you start from the base, you've got you can align that with food, then sex, and then money, right? And then you've got the heart, which is the kind of the gateway between the lower nature and the higher nature. And so you go into communication, intellect, intuition, and then connection with source.
Yes.
But the heart is the gateway between those realms.
It's almost as though the game is from the Atma, the spirit, the God spirit that lives in the heart, the spiritual heart, joining all the higher worlds with all the lower worlds.
Yeah.
And they have so many different aspects to them. When one becomes psychic, and I believe I can claim to say I'm somewhat psychic, you can see it all. You see the whole game, right?
Yeah.
Or you see parts of the game. And you can see, when you meet people, all these different worlds interacting. And the decisions that typically we make, you mentioned the mind. The mind is like an integrator of all the conscious powers and energies of all the different worlds. So all these streams of energy go from these different worlds into the mind. The mind analyzes it and does what it wants to do, and then it sends back information into all the different worlds. And so that's why we have a lot of us have confusion in our lives, because we have many different we feel there's many different directions to go, right? And that's because there are many different energies and powers going through our minds, influencing us one way or another, right? And so again, it goes back to the model of the chariot and the horses, and God being the driver, and us being the charioteer, right? that if you allow the driver to do its the driver's work, then your will becomes the will of the creator.
Yeah, the lines.
And everything's cool. Yeah.
Well, the journey becomes easier.
Yeah, and then I find it's just a big university. We're all here to learn.
We're still in kindergarten, I think, on this realm, in this humanity.
Well,
we're not all
the same, right? When you say we, I mean...
Yeah. As the collective.
You're saying a collective as humanity, but of course we're all in different places.
Yeah.
And... It's certainly a universe that seems to be built in terms of time, mm-hmm. on the concept of ignorance moving towards enlightenment.
Yeah.
So there's this great movement, this great expansion of all these activities and happenings towards the final state of oneness. Mm. So we're all in different places and different levels along this way. And there's some very easy markers to help us, you know, relate to free will or fate. And one of them, of course, is called love.
Hmm.
And so many great spirits have been here, including Jesus, who explained to us that love is the right path. Hmm. And that will lead us towards the best outcome of all these myriads of different opportunities. Hmm.
One of the guideposts, you could say, comes from Yogananda, the autobiography of a yogi, who says, do not do what you want, then you may do what you like. Right? So we're not here to just do what we want, right? Mm. Because when you just do what you want, you're not aligning with the divine will. Yeah. Align with the divine will, you like what you do.
Yes.
If that makes any sense.
Well, let me give a rather dramatic example, which is called sex, right? Now, in the Catholic Church, for example, they all, I can't remember who it was, whether it was Peter who said, you know, don't do it. Everyone's celibate, or they used to be celibate, right? The real way it should happen is that you do all these great experiences and have all these great experiments, and slowly the great creator you see visions of the great creator, and this feeling is so absolutely and utterly divine that sex just disappears. So in the end, if you do, and many of the great philosophers do become celibate in the end, right? And many of the Indian saints.
Well, from my understanding, it's transcended.
Exactly, the correct word. It's transcended because you move through all the different activities of the world towards a greater activity, a greater transcendence. Mm. And I think this is what's called the tantric path, because the tantric path allows all these different experiences.
Yeah.
But if you're focused on the right path, you know, towards this great creator, your energies and feelings and experiences become more and more and more amazing until in the end you're just lost in awe and at this wonderful experience you're having.
But on this dualistic, materialistic, physical incarnation that we're experiencing, sex is a very strong part of it, and it's sexual energy which keeps us from falling apart. And some of the stuff I've worked with, the shamans of ancient Mexico, they recommend to their apprentices to abstain from sex because it uses up their energy, right?
Yes. Well, that's,
however,
that's very true.
And well, if you don't have a great deal of energy and you start playing some of their games of going into other dimensions and all that, you won't survive. Yeah, you'll be pulled apart. Yeah. Mm. However, there are some individuals who have got so much of that inherent energy, they can have sex as often as they like with as many partners they like. This is nothing to do with morality, right? Mm. And it doesn't affect them.
Yeah.
Because they've got that inherent energy.
I brought up sex particularly. I think we're going to come to an end soon. But I brought it up to show that there are different aspects of the universe which can be active in different times of one's experience, and that the sort of focus of where we're going in this free will or fate is transcendence, as you said, and it's into an absolutely brilliant place, and its quality is love.
So what about that question I asked earlier, what about the angels that transgress on us? If we've been sent nothing but angels, which I go along with.
You mean if we are angels?
Well,
that's what I was
all
saying.
The adversaries that we encounter in life, somebody does something nasty to you, for example, right? But they're still an angel.
That'll be, we'll have that as a subject for the second video.
All right then. All right. Okay, we'll take a short break.
Yeah, thanks.
Okay.